Hi everyone. Today I'm gonna talk about a piece that I made in 2017 for an international group show that I made in Istanbul, and that show was about Silk Road, and it took place in 7 different countries along the road, and it started from Istanbul and ended at Beijing. This is a detail about the work that I made, and it's actually an interpretation of a 16th century panel at Topkapı Palace. Before I tell more about this piece, I want to just go back to an earlier piece that I made in 2014, which is the piece also I participated previously in Asian Contemporary Art Week in New York, and at the time I talked about this piece. This is actually a life-size truck, and I casted it from an actual truck, and I decorated it with a traditional Turkish style motifs. And the name of the work is Seyir and Cruise. Actually, Seyir means both watching and cruising at the same time in Turkish. And this was actually the first sculpture of mine that I started to work with the traditional motifs. And I just wanted to use because the whole topic about those alienated objects was about the alienation of the culture that I was feeling. And I was thinking it was a personal issue, then I realized when I moved to Istanbul from Ankara that it's more like a social issue. And I just started to look at the kind of culture that I inherited. And that's why I started to use the traditional motifs and what can I do with them in my art. And that's why I defragmented the traditional drawing from it's also an excerpt from a Topkapı Palace, and used it in a different scales. And actually that piece, ultimately this giant vessel brought me to, and as I said that this was a work in from 2014, and it actually brought me to this new piece, Hatayi, so it was my own journey with that vessel, and it brought me to this excerpt in a book by Walter Denny. And it says that the excerpt is, strangely, the cobalt used for the blue decoration usually came itself from the Middle East and traveled eastward to China before making the return trip in finished ceramics. And when I was trying to know more about this whole heritage, this was very fascinating sentence, because it was perfectly representing the cultural exchange through this material's own transformation. And at the time I was working on this Silk Road project, and then this blueness and the material cobalt fascinated me. I started to look for blue decorated tiles in the city I'm living in, Istanbul, and I encountered these panels you see on two of them mirroring each other. In total there are 4, and it's actually on the facade of Sünnet Odası, circumcision's room. It's the outside facade, so it's exposes the sun and rain and severe humid. It's just outside for the past 5 centuries. This is the panel I'm talking about, and it is actually made by Shah Kulu, who emigrated to Ottoman from Persia at the time. And it is believed that it's made around 1550. Actually, it is at first it looks like an ordinary florally decorated tile, but when you put attention, I mean, I'm really fascinated by the size at first because it's more than like 126 by 50. And those are, as I said, four of them at the palace, and it's completely flat. And as a ceramicist, I studied ceramic, by the way, and as a ceramicist, I really have no idea how those guys managed to have this perfectly flat slabs, like clay pieces in the 16th century conditions. And actually, this is a piece that clearly shows the Iranian and Chinese influences in them. And also, early pieces that ultimately gonna open up this new era for Isnik tiles, and the later all the more colors will be added to the whole visual vocabulary of Isnik, like the coral red and emerald green. And I'd like to just go into the detail, like visual detail of the panels. And as I said, that it looks like a florally decorated composition, but there are hidden birds in it. So there are four birds, like facing to four corners to the panel. And it is also like the phoenix, bird phoenix, used a lot in the Chinese visuality as well. And also, it reminds me to this literary piece, Conference of Birds, by poet Farid Uddin Attar from 12th century. And the story is like the birds just goes to the different side of the world to look for their kings and King Simorgh, and ultimately found themselves. And this is another detail. These are Kilins. Kilin is a mythological creatures. And they had different depictions for different eras in China. But here we see dragon, deer, and tiger. It's a mixture of animals. And it is believed that they lived in enchanted forests. Hatayi, the piece that I made, I named it Hatayi, and it actually comes from the name of this specific drawing of a flower, which is an intersection of any flower that the Turkish traditional art named it like Hatayi. But it is actually the evolution of the flower lotus that, you know, all these porcelain traveled along the Silk Road. They had the lotus flower motifs on them and somehow evolved to Hatayi, and the name that originated like Hatay and Katayan, those also kind of indicates the geographical evolution. And also the feathery sow's leaves are very characteristic to the time of the 16th century ceramics, and it gives this dynamism to the whole composition, because before that it was the tiles were more like modularly repeating themselves, but in this example, for example, we see more painterly quality, so they're kind of moving around, and as I said, it's a one-piece work, it's not like the tiles are like repeating themselves. And actually, at the time, Mimar Sinan, the architect, genius architect, was the head of the palace, head architect. And Şahkulu, who did the drawing, was the head of the Nakkashhane. Nakkashhane is the royal art and design shop. And at the time, the Sultan was Süleyman the Magnificent. So that was the era that the culturally had this huge impact on arts. And I'm gonna show some drawings from Shah Kulu. And Shah Kulu, as I said, he's from Persia. He's immigrated from Tabriz. And he supervised the production of the palace court, and not only drawings and ceramics, but also carpets and other mediums, metals. They supervised the production of the whole empire. This is another drawing, and these are probably quite familiar to you. This is actually, I found it in a book that it's very interesting because it's a little detail about Arslanhane and Nakkashhane. It is said that the Nakkashhane was just upstairs of Arslanhane where they kept the wild animals and lions. And I like to kind of speculate if Shah Kulu, inspired by those lions, like living downstairs while doing the killings, actually. I find that an interesting coincidence. And this is another detail from the same panel. And actually, what I'm really fascinated by is that this delicate brush stroke. I don't know if any of you tried making or drawing ceramics, but ceramic is a like extremely absorbent surface, so it's really not easy to control the paint over it, and those details really fascinate me when I first see them. And another thing is the material's memory that keeps all these movements for centuries. And ceramic is hard to make, but once you're able to make the work, it just stays for forever. So it is another side of this material that makes me attracted to it. And when I was talking about this drawing, it's also, I'd like to talk about the material cobalt, which gives the color blue to the ceramic surface when fired. And it, interesting point is that in China, the cobalt wasn't pure enough to give the deepest and various hues of blue. So it was actually imported material from Persia. And just like the artist himself, so Persia was the source of this material. And here are some information about cobalt. And it's a very precious chemical element, and it named differently in different places. And Persians said, actually, lajavart to the stone. And in today's Turkish, I mean, lajavart means navy blue. It's a like word that we use every day. And also, when cobalt was imported to China, they called it Suleiman or Mohammedan blue. And then actually I searched for where the cobalt comes from then, and I found out that it's actually the German folklore, they named this goblin lives underground and protects or haunts the mine. They called it like cobalt. So, yeah. And this is the work that I made. So I'm gonna go back to the work and talk a little bit about the making process. And I mean, first we did the tracing of the Shah Kulu's drawing. We followed the drawing, and then we copied the, like digitally copied the piece. And I actually rescaled the piece in 3 meters, so it's a much bigger version of the original panel, and parted in 62 parts. And this is how I made the surface of the piece. I just wanted to create this random mousse by just, I just softened the clay and create this, wanted to create some sort of a movement, just like the chakras, like feather leaves. And this is how we shape the pieces. Actually, this is a water jet, transfers the drawing to the fired, bisque-fired pieces, as you see. And this is how the pieces completed itself, like a puzzle. This is before the glazing, so cobalt looks like pinkish after the glaze, like firing. It has this amazing spectrum from neon blue to black, which I really like. And this is how we mounted the piece on aluminum base. And this is how it looked like. And I just wanted to cast a shadow from one palace to another. So the original of the panel was in Ottoman Topkapı Palace, and it's in French Palace. So the idea was kind of reflecting it from past to today. And this is again the panel itself that I'm living for some time. And this is me in front of the panel. And actually, this panel worked like a gateway to me. I mean, when I first started to this journey to know my culture more with the work Seyir, I didn't know that it would go this far. But the more I research about it, the more I'm exploring and seeing how connected this region is, and realizing that there are like too much things to explore more. And yeah, that's it. Thank you.